right. Good morning, church. How are y'all? I thought the video was going to be a little longer. My bad. Oh, my goodness. Well, this morning, it's good to see everybody in early. Normally, the room fills up as we get going, and good to see all of you here. I hope that means you got lots of energy, that you're ready to praise the Lord, that this morning you're ready to engage, not just with the church body, but listen, you're here to engage with the Lord. He wants to speak, and He wants to hear your heart. He wants you to pray to Him. He wants you to worship Him this morning, so I hope that you've come ready to do just that. You've walked into a wonderful place if you're a guest. This church family, I can't tell you how blessed I am to pastor this place, and this church loves Jesus. This church is serious about discipleship, it's serious about mission, and I just cannot tell you the blessing that I hope that you find as you walk in these doors and you're greeted by this church family. If you're looking for a church home, I hope that you'll find it right here at Hepzibah. When you walked in, there's actually like a guest information desk on the very bottom part of our lobby. If you didn't take a moment to fill out a guest card, I hope that you'll do that if you're a first-time guest. We want to reach out to you, and I hope that by your coming today that if you're looking for a church family, we want to tell you about the things that God's doing here. We want to know more about you as well, and the only way we can accomplish that is if we get one of those cards back. So take a moment. You can tell us how you want to be contacted, email, phone calls. We'd be happy to come by and make a visit as well. But we want to do that, so just take that moment. We want to say thank you for being here, and we want to welcome you this morning. Our team is back from Guatemala. We welcome them back. I don't want to steal John's thunder, so I'm not going to tell you all the amazing things that the Lord has done this week in Guatemala. If you want to have your life changed, if you want to see ministry in a different light, with a different set of eyes, if you want to see what I really believe the early church looked like, you need to go to Guatemala. It will not only prepare you for being a faithful witness, it'll show you what the church of Jesus Christ is supposed to be. And I hope that every life that went was changed, not just in the way they got to go share the gospel and see folks saved, but I know that they got as much as they gave. And so my daughter was one of those, and I just pray that it has a forever impact on them. So thank John and those folks when you see them. Tracy, who heads up that, thank them for the work that they have been doing. This morning is a special morning for us as a church body. As I said on a video a few weeks ago, sometimes news comes at us that's great news and it's tough news at the same time. And so if you've watched that video, you know that we are sending off one of our staff members. I don't say that we're losing them, because what God has built here and what God has done with the family here, especially within our staff, even though Nathan is going to be moving on, if you've not heard, Nathan has accepted a call to a church in Knoxville, Tennessee. It's called First Baptist Concord. It's one of the great churches in our convention. It is a large church, and it is a great opportunity for Nathan, not only in the ministry reach and the kingdom impact that he'll be able to have with the thousands of people that attend there, but more importantly, he works with a great group of men. One of them is one of his mentors, someone that he looks up to and loves and respects and has known for years and really helped mold and shape him early in ministry. His name's Alan Taylor. If you're a Sunday school teacher, you've probably read Alan's books. He's like the guru of SBC's Connect groups. And so Nathan is blessed with this opportunity. I don't want anybody to think ever, I can't tell you how much our staff love one another and the friendships that we have. I know an instinct is something wrong, or I wonder what happened that made Nathan leave. Listen, it's none of that. We celebrate with him this opportunity because we know, just like Jordan, just like Kevin Wilson, all these other folks, David Edgel, they may leave, but they're still family and they still are friends, and we're still going to make those connections. So Nathan, I want you to come up and just share with the church a few minutes what's on your heart, and let's celebrate with Nathan this great opportunity the Lord has given to him.
Good morning, church. Hey, there we go. Well, thank you so much. I've been on the back wall talking with many of you this morning and over the last just a few weeks, because some of you have heard even before Aaron made his announcement, but we couldn't say anything official until, I mean, you guys know it has to go through church votes and committees and things like that. But we're excited for the new opportunity that we have in Tennessee. but sad also to leave here. We were very happy here and weren't looking, and Alan called, a longtime mentor, and offered me this position, and we really struggled for a while about whether that was the call for us, and whether God wanted us to be there. We just felt like that's where God was leading us, and so, you know, if God is leading us there, then God is doing other plans here. And so, church, I want you to know that you guys will always be in our hearts. We love you so much, and so it's been a great opportunity to serve here. And where this isn't goodbye forever. My in-laws are still here. We'll be back to visit and still be a part of it. You guys have walked through us with us in good times and in bad. We've been through a lot, like just personally, as a family. And so you guys have been great to kind of walk through those things with us. I mean, if you're going to have personal struggles and hurts and bad diagnoses, this is the place to be, because Hepzibah knows how to love on people. I know those that have been on the receiving end of it here know that very much. And I want you to know, church, that we love this place, and we love and appreciate Aaron and Kevin and Blake and Jason, all the staff here. We're going to be greatly, missing them, and they'll still continue to be our friends and our ministry partners. And so I know that this church, even though as we leave here, that this church is in great hands under Aaron's leadership and the staff's leadership here. And I look forward to seeing how God's going to continue just the legacy that he's begun here, not even through staff. I know Aaron is obviously the lead pastor, but I know he would tell you too. The reason why Hepzibah is where it is today is not even because of us as a staff, but it's because of you as a church body. And so I just want to say thank you for the 7 years that we've had here, and I hope you will stay in touch. I'll keep my same phone number so you guys can call anytime and stay in touch. So thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you. And let's be honest, is Jenny here as well? Where's Jenny? Raise your hand. Jenny, just stand up so we can say thank you to you as well and your family. I love Nathan, but you're the better half. So, no, he knows that. So, but we are grateful, Jenny, your impact. It's not just Nathan. It's the impact that you have had on so many women in this church and so many ministries in this church and your children. They are such a blessing to all of us. You guys are going to be missed. It won't be the same. But we're grateful that the roots run deep, and I'm also grateful that you're not taking your parents with you. That is amazing. At least we didn't feel like we lost the whole clan. And but thank you guys for all that you do. Church, I want to remind you the 24th of August or of July is going to be the time from 6 to 7 that we get to kind of send them off. You'll get a chance to speak with them. If you'd like to give them any kind of gift, you can do it certainly during that time. But just let's come together and let's fellowship. It's going to be a fiesta. I don't know if that means tacos. That would be amazing. I don't know what that means or what's going to be there. But whatever that looks like, whatever that is, be there from 6 to 7. And on that same night, we're going to have a Q&A. Not only do we get to say that, you know, here we are with Nate leaving, we're blessed as a church that God has already raised up the people around us and within this body that can step into these positions and lead. And so John Wilson is being brought as the name that we'd like to see step into the position of what will become hopefully an associate pastor of discipleship and missions. So we are excited for John to have this opportunity as well. So I hope that you guys will come to that Q&A. That'll be at 7 o'clock on that same evening. And then the 8th of August is when we'll vote on John Wilson's name for that position. So listen, the future is bright here at Hepzibah. It has been bright. It continues to be bright for 212 years or however long it's been. God has continued to move in this place. So listen, he's in control and he has our future. And all we have to keep doing is saying yes to Jesus, and he's going to do some amazing things. So church, let's stand, let's celebrate, let's worship. Let God hear your voices this morning as we sing.
Church, let's raise our voices and praise the Lord as we worship together. Let our praise be your welcome. Let our songs be a sign. We are here for you. We are here for you. Let your breath come from heaven, fill our hearts with your life. We are here for you. We are here for you. Oh, may this be true. To you our hearts are open. Nothing here is hidden. You are our one desire. You alone are holy. Only you are worthy. God, let your fire fall down. Let our shout your anthem, your renown, fill the sky. We are here for you, Jesus. We are here for you. Let your word move in power. Let what's dead.
Savior is done. See how his love
Romans chapter 5, starting in verse 6, says this: "For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us. You know this, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." So we can get excited because he has done great things, but the greatest thing is the way that he has shown his love by laying down his life, that we might be free, that we might live. And so this morning, I just want us to consider the goodness of our God, the way he loves us, and respond.
So good to me. Church, you can have a seat. Good morning. It's good to see you guys. I couldn't think of a better song to sing. You know, Kevin, I think it was the second verse that said, the dead are raised, the sinner saved by the work of your power. You know, Church, some of you guys might think that God only did miracles in the Bible, but that's what we got. That's what we got to see all week. We got to see dead people come back to life. We got to see sinners saved, and I couldn't be more excited to tell you guys. You ought to be so proud of the team of students and young adults and leaders that we sent to Guatemala. They did the hard work of the ministry, but it's rewarding work, church. We worked in a couple of towns this past week, just two, really. And, you know, I got to thinking about it on the way home. Two towns that are not really all that different from Window. There are a couple of towns outside a major city, just people living, working, small towns, one called Cauquet and one called Chinico, where we already had a few believers. And all we did all week long, church, was go door to door, was find people on the street and share the gospel with them. There was no camp, there was no event, there was no gathering. So when you see, if some of you guys have been seeing pictures online and you see the kind of response that we had to the gospel, it wasn't in a room like this. It wasn't preaching to a crowd. It was one-on-one, one gospel share at a time. And by my best guess, I believe we shared the gospel something like 170 times one-on-one in the course of a week, and saw over 60 people repent and believe and turn to Christ. So let's give the Lord a hand. In those two towns, God is certainly working and moving, and it's not our work, because you could tell as we fumbled through, tried desperately to get people to translate what we were saying into Spanish, it didn't have anything to do with us. It had everything to do with God moving and working. I can't help but think that that could absolutely be Wendell if we would get that message out and share the gospel. Over the course of this week, we also had an opportunity to baptize almost a dozen people, some of them in unexpected places, some of them in the back of a store, some of them with just whatever we had around, some of them in their house because they couldn't get out. They were bedridden, but they wanted to repent, they wanted to believe, and they wanted to follow Jesus in obedience and be baptized. Church, I couldn't say more about this week, and I hope that you will take some time, talk to any of the folks that went to Guatemala. They would love to tell you about it, and we'll look forward to, in a few weeks, having a video for you to really detail everything that happened. But church, God is at work. He is moving. Disciples are being made. People are being trained. I didn't even mention that. Almost every one of those people that repented and believed, and some people that we met that were just believers, we just stopped right on the spot. And some of them we spent 20 minutes with, some of them we spent an hour with, trying to help them understand what it means to follow Jesus in obedience and to share the gospel. It's work that's going to pay off for years and years and years to come. So stop somebody that went, ask them about it. They would love to tell you. And as our ushers are coming forward, I wanted to tell you about one other opportunity. I want to really remind you, because it's been in the postings that have gone out. We talked about it a couple of weeks ago. But after the second service this morning, right out here in the Mission Center, we're going to have a meeting about how we're going to serve Wendell. I told you guys that this was something that Paul had brought to me, and I couldn't help but think this is exactly what we need to be doing. We need to be caring for the people around us that need care. And we have people right here in this church that are gifted to do that. And I know I've mentioned before, if you have any skilled trade, we would welcome that. If you have just the ability to want to help people, even if you don't have a skilled trade, I think we're absolutely going to need that. And I had somebody come to me a couple weeks ago and said, well, could you use somebody that can teach ESL? And I was like, well, we hadn't planned for that. But yes, I am confident if you want to serve this community and you have some gifting or some ability that God has given you, this is really just an opportunity for us to get together and talk about what those things are, so we know, as we see requests come in, how we can serve this community, and how, more importantly than that, we can create opportunities for us to share the gospel so that we can see many people in Wendell repent and believe and turn and be saved and follow Jesus in the way that he has meant for us to. So, church, I look forward to seeing you then. Brother Matt, why don't you pray for us this morning?
Father God, Lord, we love you. God, we thank you for today. God, we thank you for the awesome news coming out of Guatemala. God, that that despite the travel restrictions and all the things that have gone on throughout the world that has kind of grinded everything to a halt, God, that you haven't stopped. God, that your gospel is still going out, that people still need salvation, that there are still people that that are alone and lost in their sins. But God, that you are gracious and merciful and slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. Father, I pray that you would cause us to give sacrificially, to give graciously. And God, that that every dollar that we give, that you would multiply, and that you would use it to not further our kingdom or further our church or further the name of Hepzibah, but God, that you would further your kingdom, and that it would all go for your glory, and that you might be made famous in Wendell and Zebulun and Knightdale, throughout our state, throughout our country, and to the ends of the earth. And God, we just love you and we thank you in Jesus' name.
Church, if you'll turn with me in the Bible, we are going to continue in our series on the life of David out of the book of 2 Samuel. And again, 2 Samuel, the main focus of this book is the life of King David. And as you know, we've completed the book of 1 Samuel and Saul's life, and Saul is still being mentioned as we get into 2 Samuel, because one thing that is still lacking in the life of Israel is something that is extremely important if God is going to move and if God is going to work. I cannot tell you enough. I can't overestimate the importance of unity according to the Word of God. You may not realize it, but the reason so many churches struggle, the reason the kingdom of God probably is hindered in the advancement of the gospel, is because so many churches struggle in disunity. If you've ever been in a church that's unhealthy, you know the blessing of being in a church that is healthy. If you've ever sat in business meetings and scratched your head and wondered, where is Jesus in all of this? All I hear is, will I? And we ask the question, where is the unity that comes from being a body of believers who are one body, who share one spirit, who have one hope for the calling, right? We have one faith, one baptism. We have one Father over all, according to the Scripture. And yet sometimes, not just even in churches, but I hope what we talk about today, that you see the importance of unity in your marriage, in all of your relationships with other believers. Because if God, listen, if God is going to move, He's going to move among a people who are unified. So this morning, we're going to take a look at what unity is, what it looks like. We're going to take a look at what disunity does to us and the toll that it takes on the church and our own personal lives. And we're going to see that out of the book of 2 Samuel, chapter 4 and chapter 5, that there is a great deal of important information that we can learn that is going to benefit us in our daily lives and our lives as we move together as a church called Hepzibah. So let me read to you first chapter 4, and we'll take some time there in chapter 4. The reading of the Word of God says in chapter 4, verse 1 of 2 Samuel, "Now when Ishbosheth, Saul's son, heard that Abner had died in Hebron, he lost courage. And all of Israel was disturbed. Saul's son had two men who were commanders of the bands." Not the bands like music bands, but like the bands of the armies. "The name of the one was Baana, and the other name was Rechab. Sons of Ramon the Barathite, the sons of Benjamin, for Barath is also considered part of Benjamin. And the Barathites fled to Gideon and have been aliens there until this day," and you'll see why. "Now Jonathan, Saul's son, had a cripple, or I'm sorry, now Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son crippled in his feet. He was 5 years old when the report of Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel, and the nurse took him up and fled. And it happened that in her hurry to flee, he fell, and he became lame, and his name was Mephibosheth. So the sons of Ramon the Berethite and Rechab the sons of Baana departed and came to the house of Ishbosheth in the heat of the day while he was taking his midday rest. They came in the middle of the house as if to get wheat, and they struck him in the belly. And Rechab and Baana, his brother, they escaped. When they came into the house, he was lying on the bed in his bedroom. They struck him, and they killed him, and they beheaded him. They took his head and traveled by way of the Arabah all night. When they brought the head of Ishbosheth to David at Hebron and said to the king, "Behold, the head of Ishbosheth, the son of Saul, your enemy, who sought your life, thus the Lord has given my lord the king vengeance this day on Saul and his descendants." David answered Rechab and Baana, his brother, sons of Ramona the Berethite, and he said to them, "As the Lord lives, who has redeemed my life from all distress, when one told me, saying, 'Behold, Saul is dead,' and thought he was bringing good news, I seized him and killed him in Ziklag, which was the reward that I gave him for his news. How much more when wicked men have killed a righteous man in his own house, on his own bed, shall I not now require his blood from your hand and destroy you from the earth?" Then David commanded the young men, and they killed them and cut off their hands and feet, hung them up beside the pool in Hebron. But they took the head of Ishbosheth, and they buried it in the grave of Abner in Hebron. Spurgeon said of unity, let me read these words to you. He said, "Satan always hates Christian fellowship." Did you know that? The word for fellowship in the Bible that most often that we should think of is the Greek word koinonia. Koinonia is an interesting word because it actually means that we share everything in common. You know, when you think of fellowship as Baptists, we tend to think of meals, right? We tend to think of the fellowship hall, and it's a place where we just gather and we eat and we hang out, and that's kind of fellowship. Well, listen, the Bible speaks of a greater fellowship than that. It is the idea and the understanding that we share a deep community. And how could we not share a deep community, considering that if the Spirit of God in you is leading you and the Spirit of God is in me leading me and He is one Spirit, then guess what we're going to be able to do? We're going to be able to go one direction, aren't we? And what the devil needs to do, if he's ever going to have a chance at disrupting what God is doing, he's got to try to get in and disrupt the fellowship of Christian believers. Satan always hates Christian fellowship. It is his policy to keep Christians apart, Spurgeon said. Anything which can divide saints from one another, he delights in. Since union is strength, he does his best to promote separation. What I want you to see this morning in chapter 4 and our first point of the message this morning is that disunity will always take its toll. As I told you, if you've ever been in a church that is disunified, let me tell you what's happening to that church, and they don't know it. It's dying. When disunity is sown within a body of believers, the people who are called to belong to God. Remember, we're not talking about a lost group, a pagan group. What we're talking about today is either the Church of Christ as understood in the New Testament or in the Old Testament. These are the Jews. These are the people who were called of God. These people were literally, in the most real sense, family. These are Abraham's descendants, right? These are the 12 sons of Jacob. And yet what we find is for all these years that God has freed them from slavery, He freed them from the Egyptians, He took them out and He gave them the land that He promised to Abraham. Every promise that God gave His children, all of it had come true. God had been faithful, and rather than them coming around the promises and the Word of God, here they are after all these years still completely divided. And when you look at this chapter, I mean, it is filled with treachery. When you think about who killed Ishbosheth, it wasn't even the tribes of Judah. what ought to stand out to you is that Saul's family, they were the Benjamites. I mean, think about how far things had gone. Think about how much people had turned against one another to the point that even family could not see themselves as family. So Benjamites, they were the ones. And you say, why would the Benjamites kill the one who would likely take the throne of Saul? If this was Saul's son and they believed that the throne was supposed to be with the family of Saul, it's almost unconscionable to think about someone walking in, a Benjamite, and beheading Ishbosheth and stabbing him through the belly as he laid in bed taking a nap. But let me tell you why it is. Because most disunity, you know what it's founded upon? Just pure, unadulterated selfishness. Selfishness, it's cruel. What these two men believed was that they had an opportunity to promote themselves. They had an opportunity to kill Ishbosheth, and it's the same mistake that the gentleman made, and David's going to refer to it, back when Saul was killed. If you remember, the guy came with the necklaces, and he came with all that was Saul's, and he looks at King David, and he says, listen, I found Saul, and he wasn't quite dead yet. And when I walked up to him, remember, he said that I went ahead and killed him and I've brought you all this stuff. And he thought David was going to reward him. He thought David was going to give him a place of honor. And yet David looked at him and said, you're telling me you killed the Lord's anointed? And it's crazy to me that these men had yet to see that Saul was not David's enemy as far as David was concerned. Isn't it amazing that within our families, within the body of Christ, that we can actually get to the point that we see family as enemies? I mean, you want to talk about disunity taking a toll when you have people who live under the same roof. They can't trust each other. They can't find it within themselves to support each other. When you've got a bunch of people who live in one place, who say that they're trying to accomplish one thing, they have a purpose, they have a plan that's in front of them that's been given to them, but all they can think about is how it affects themselves. Imagine, I mean, because most of us, listen, some of us in this room, we may not have to imagine very hard what a home looks like when everybody does what they want to do without any concern for the other people in that home. Treachery. I mean, listen to what it says, that in this moment in Israel's history, when they should be together, when they should be advancing God's kingdom in their lifetime and doing the things that God has asked them to do, right off the bat in the first verse, it says that Ishbosheth, he's sitting there, and it literally means that he lost courage. It says that his hands are down. It basically, in the most base sense, it just means he doesn't know what to do anymore. Abner's dead. The only reason he's on the throne is because Abner propped him up. If you remember, Abner just got killed. And he's got to be thinking to himself, what in the world is going to happen to me? What in the world is going to happen to my family? I wish he could have believed. I wish he could have trusted the people around him. But disunity, you know what it does? The toll that it takes is it robs us even of the most basic trust. We can't even take people at their word. And all he had to do was stop and think for a moment. All he had to do was listen to the reports of how every time that Saul was brought up, David never treated Saul like an enemy. All he had to do was remember the promises that he made to Jonathan, where he told Jonathan that no matter what happens, whatever the issue is that your father has with me, it's not going to come between us, and I'm going to continue to treat you like the family that you are, and our friendship will endure. And literally, he did everything that screamed, that he meant the words that he said. Yet not just Ishbosheth, but because of the treachery of these men, because of the things that were happening with Abner, because of all the shenanigans, listen to what was happening. It says that even all of Israel, did you catch the word? It says they were disturbed. Unsettled. Nothing will rob you of peace quicker than disunity. It causes us to be disturbed. Let me ask you a question. Who wants to be part of a group of people that are always complaining and fighting? We wonder sometimes why churches are dying at the rate that they are. Literally thousands of churches every year close their doors. You know why? Because nobody wants to walk into a room where music is more important than the hearts and lives of other people. Who wants to be part of a group that would write another person off because they disagreed with the color of the carpet that should be put in the church lobby? Here's what the Bible taught us. And here's what Jesus said, and he made it very clear, didn't he? He said that if you want to let people know that you're actually my disciples, if you want them to see me, if you want them to understand who I am, if you want them to be drawn, because remember it says that if you'll simply lift up the Son of Man, just like remember in the Old Testament when Moses raised up the serpent that was on the pole on the stake, remember? They had been bitten by snakes, and he said, if you just look and believe and put your faith in God that he can save you, and the faith step was looking and believing that they would be healed from those bites. Remember, he said, just as that was lifted up in the desert and the people were saved, he says, lift up the Son of Man. And men will come and men will be saved. I want you to correlate that to what Jesus had to say later on in the book of John and in other places. And the apostles would say the exact same thing, that you know what? The world will know that you're his disciples in the way that you love each other. And if we can't love each other, what makes you think someone's going to walk in the door and be part of what we're saying God is doing here? Folks, don't take for granted, because as I give this lesson, I want to tell you right now, every time I come back onto this campus, I think, because when I go to meetings at other churches, if I go to something with the state convention, if I meet with our pastors' network in this community, if I go to the Southern Baptist Convention, I go to those places and I hear how desperately disunified so many churches are around this country. And when I get back to Hepzibah, I literally am overwhelmed with gratefulness that this is a unified body. But let me tell you something. Do not take it for granted. Do not think for a second that the devil has stopped trying to divide us, to get us sidetracked off of God's purposes by making us fight with each other. The reason most churches are not outwardly looking at the world is because they can't quit looking and fighting with each other. And folks, God has given us a great gift at Hepzibah. And I want you to see, as we're going to talk here in a minute, you're going to come to understand something that is very important for us, and that is that we don't build unity. We keep it. That's what's biblical. It's not within us to build unity. Let me show you what I mean. You can see in the story where everything has just broken loose in Israel. The people are disturbed. There's treachery. There's so much concern that the northern kingdom is worried what the southern kingdom is going to do. And can David love us? Can David forgive us? Would David be willing to lead us after we have stood against him and set up another throne? And there's all this. The focus is on what is disturbing them. And the country is becoming paralyzed. Ishbosheth is paralyzed. And then these two men take into their hands to try to force unity by killing Ishbosheth, and they take the head to David, and David's like, what have you done? Remember that David wants a united kingdom. You can't force unity. You realize that. I'll never forget when I became pastor at Hepzibah. We sat right in that room back there, and as I went to my Q&A, back then music was the big deal at Hepzibah. How are we going to transition music? What did it look like for our church as I came on board as pastor and we knew that there would be directional changes and everybody was consumed with music and everybody was consumed a little bit with politics in that moment. Politics is always the thing lurking in the shadows, right? And I'll never forget, someone stood up in that meeting and they said, Pastor Aaron, I want you to tell us how you are going to bring unity to this church. And you know what? Out of all the questions, that wasn't one that I had thought of. I thought they were going to want to know, you know, what is your view on Calvinism? What is your view on women in ministry? What is your view? You know, I just expected the standard, you know, whatever. And at first, it took me back a little bit. I kind of was like, and the longer I stood there and thought about it, and I'm praying in my head, Lord, don't let me say something stupid, right? That's what you do during Q&As. And beyond a shadow of a doubt, I heard God speak in that moment. I waited probably about 5 seconds before felt like a minute. And the Lord said to me very clearly, Aaron, you are not the source of unity in this church. I am. And the unity of this church is bound up in something far greater than who is leader and who is pastor. Because here's the thing, pastors are going to come and go, aren't they? And I had that realization in that moment, and it's all I knew to say to the dear woman that had asked the question. I said, all that I'm going to do is I'm going to get up, and guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to preach the Word of God. And I said, then you're going to have to make a decision. And you're going to have to make a decision. And Gordon, you're going to have to make a decision on whether or not you obey the Word of God. Because the only thing that's going to draw us together is us being like-minded around the Word, the promises, the commands of God, that we let His Spirit lead us and we all say yes to God. Because if all of us are sitting here saying yes to the Lord, then my only job is to preach the Word and your job is to obey the Word. And if we're all obeying, guess what's going to happen? We're going to find unity. David doesn't want a kingdom built on murder and treachery. He doesn't want a kingdom built on force. He wants a kingdom built on love and trust and faith. Centered not around even him and his throne, but the God who he represents. The God who he is following, who he's trying to bring glory to. And that leads us, secondly, to unity is only possible when we all surrender to the true King. Folks, that's where we have to keep going. That's where we keep unity in the body of Christ, because if we get disunified, yes, it will take its toll, but as we are unified, listen to what it says. I mean, the Word of God over and over shows us that unity is only possible if we all surrender to the true King. Look at chapter 5. It says, all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron. And they said, behold, we are bone and your bone and your flesh. What the Israelites said is, what are we doing? We are sitting here fighting all this treachery, all this disturbance within the people of God. They are recognizing, why is it this way? What are we? What does he say we are? What did the Israelites say? We're flesh and bone, right? I mean, that's just another way of saying we are family. We are brothers. And it would have been unconscionable to think that the Benjamites killed their own king who was sitting on the throne. I mean, how could that possibly be happening? How could they have gotten that far? And they look and they say, you know what, listen, David, we're family. And they go on and they say, previously, when Saul was king over us, even when Saul was king, listen to their confession. You were the one who led Israel, what? Out and in? Why can't we see the good in each other? Why is it so difficult to trust the way that finally these people are beginning to trust? Because of all the things that may have been said about David, that people may have thought about David, you see what they're coming back to? The reality is that even when you were serving under Saul, you were faithful. Even when you were serving under Saul, David, you were loyal. You weren't concerned for the crown. You weren't concerned for getting on the throne. You could have killed Saul twice at least, and you chose not to do it. Instead, what you did was you led faithfully in the place that God had you until God wanted to move you the place that he had planned for you. Sometimes, folks, that is one of the hardest things to do in ministry. And yet they looked at David, and that's exactly what they saw in him. They went on, and this is what's very important. It says, and beyond the fact that you're family, beyond the fact that you're faithful, It's the Lord that said to you. So here's where real unity comes. It's the Lord who said to you, you will shepherd my people Israel, and you will be a ruler over Israel. You see, the crux of real unity is our ability and our willingness to find unity around His Word. God is not looking for unity at any cost. Folks, we don't compromise truth to have unity. But most times, churches aren't arguing over truth. Most times, families that are in complete disunity, they're not arguing over truth. They're not arguing over eternal things. They're not arguing over things that truly matter. Folks, God is not saying that unity comes at any cost. It's centered around God's Word. True biblical unity is centered on the words of God. Because if we're all focused on this, if we're all obeying this, if we're all trusting this, then listen, we may as well just yoke ourselves together because it's going to take us one direction. This word becomes like a yoke for us so that we don't go different directions, so we don't become concerned with things that don't matter. We get in the word and we see what it's saying and we see where it's leading and we simply find ourselves yoked. And these people, what brought them ultimately together was, this is God's will. It doesn't matter what those two men say. It doesn't matter what Abner says. It doesn't matter what Joab says. It technically doesn't matter what anybody says. It all boils down to what has God said. And it was God that said, you will be king. And when everybody got their heart settled on that, now the kingdom's moving. Now peace is coming. Because you see, anytime you get five Baptists in a room, you got 10 opinions, right? Given enough time, and if I talk to you long enough, I can make most of you disagree with yourself. It isn't about all seeing things the same way. It isn't that we remove personality for the sake of unity. It isn't, listen, unity isn't unanimity, meaning that we all would think the same or vote the same or do the same things. But what it does mean is we're fully concerned with what does God say is right, good, and holy? What are His purposes and plans? What is His mission? And the second question, if we need it, and if we get any further than that, it's got to be, what are the needs and concerns of others? Because according to the Word of God, I've got to put those before what? Before me. If we just did those two things, it would make all the difference in the world in our families. God, what are you asking me? God, what am I supposed to do? God, I'm going to follow you with my whole heart. And if everybody in the family is saying that, and then you come in behind that with, and I'm going to live my life for everyone else in this family, do you realize that my counseling would disappear? We find unity around His Word. We find unity around surrender and obedience to that word. Because it doesn't matter if we know what God's word says. I've been in business meetings where literally they say, well, I know God said blah, blah, blah. And then you can see it coming and you're like, don't say it. Don't say it. Because you can't say I know what God's word says and then finish with what? But. There's no but. Whatever but you're about to bring into it, is about to say, but I, because I's coming after the but. There's so many things I could say there, but I'm going to leave it there. Folks, we surrender to God and to what is revealed. And we don't build unity, rather we keep unity. Believers, I love what Joni Erickson Tada said. She said, believers are never told to become one. Did you know that? Believers are never told to become one. They are already one. The thing is, we're expected to act like it, she said. Think about that. We're not told to be one. We are one. The issue is, are we acting like it? The Bible tells us in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, 1 through 6, it literally tells us and explains it this way. It says that there is one body, there is one spirit, one hope of our calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one Father of all. And folks, if you want unity to happen in the church of Jesus Christ, let me tell you where unity starts. These men, these elders of Israel, it goes on in verse 3 and it says, all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them before the Lord at Hebron, and they anointed David king over Israel. He was 30 years old when he became king. He reigned for 40 years. At Hebron, he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months. In Jerusalem, he reigned 33 years over all of Israel and Judah. You know what's interesting is, again, David being the picture of Christ, the type of Christ. Understand in our spiritual walk, the king doesn't need to change. We need to change. Have you realized that yet? God's not wrong. You're not praying in hopes that somehow God will change. You know what you're actually praying? That I will change. You know where unity usually begins and why it's so hard to find it? Is because when we think about unity, we're always thinking about, you need to change. Not me. You need to change. If she would just, if he would just, and we're trying our whole life to manipulate everybody around us to become what we want them to become, let me tell you how unity really begins when we stop and we simply look at ourselves. You may not realize it. The only person you can change in this entire world is you. And if you're spending your time in your life trying to change everybody else around you, you are going to be disturbed. You are going to end up being manipulative. You are going to end up having so many issues because I'm telling you, unity doesn't begin in examining others. It begins in examining ourselves. It doesn't begin in demanding others to change, but it begins when we admit that we need change. And that's what happened. These men of Israel finally, based on the fact that they were already one, they are Israel, all of them, not north, south, not Ishbosheth, David, they are one people. And they have a king who has already been faithful, and if something is happening and something is wrong, they came to the realization, it's not the king, who is it? It's me. And they came back, and they repented. And they made a covenant with the king. Lastly, unity allows us to focus on the real enemy. You ever see the video online? I saw it last year. I should have probably put it up. I just didn't think about it till just now. Where you got the two antelope or whatever they are and they're fighting each other. It's a really cool video because these two antelope, you know, they got their horns and they're locked up, and it's kind of this widescreen view of like the Serengeti Plains or whatever. And you don't realize it because you're so focused on the two antelope that are butting heads and they're fighting, right? Two antelope against each other, and all of a sudden you start to realize that there is a lion running up in the screen. And I mean, because I rewound it and watched it again, that lion had been coming. I mean, if you were focused not on those two fighting antelope, but if you're looking at the screen behind them, there is this lion that is charging at them. And I mean, he was running full steam, I don't know how many hundreds of yards. And eventually, while these two are fighting, what happens? The lion runs in and just, I mean, kills them. And what a picture of what happens. That when we are focused on fighting each other, family, right? When we're so focused on self, do you realize how easy it is for the enemy to just come charging in and to destroy and to kill? Here's what I believe, and you can write this down. If you ain't gonna write nothing else down, unity is the key to reaching the world for Christ. That's what Jesus meant when he said, they will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another. The world will only be reached when they see love in us. Unity in us, if they walk into our churches and they walk into our lives and all they hear is gossip and all they hear is slander and all they hear is disunity and all they hear is, well, they think this, but we think this, and our pastor wants to do this, but we want to do that, and he said this, and she... When that's what people find, you realize it robs us of the power of the message that we're speaking. D.L. Moody said it this way. He said, I've never yet known the Spirit of God to work where the Lord's people were divided. I really believe if you had been at Hephzibah for years, I know that a lot of families are new and being here in the last couple years, 3 years. I want to tell you that one of the greatest things that happened over the years at Hephzibah Baptist Church, I watched what we're talking about happen in this family and in this place. Because ultimately, people ask me all the time. I was at a meeting with church planters a few months ago, and they ask us, how do we get where we are with the mission partnerships and with church planting and all these things? And how does a church get there? We're so focused on just trying to maintain and this, that, and the other. And I told them, I said, listen, the greatest threat to Hephzibah back in those days was the disunity. I mean, do y'all remember? If y'all were here a long time, I mean, I remember business meetings were literally like they were having a vote, and we were like, you go on this side. If you vote yes, you go. I mean, it felt like the Hatfields and McCoys. I mean, they may as well have given us muskets and said, all right, take 10 steps, turn around and shoot each other. The anger, the resentment, the meetings after the meetings in the hallways, all of it robbing us of unity. And guess what? We would spend so much time trying to fix those things. You know what we weren't actually doing? We were so concerned with ourselves, we didn't have time to be concerned about the world. We were so concerned about what we were going to do here and arguing over what was going to happen here that we didn't have any thought or concept of, you know what, that really all that we have, we ought to be focused out there. Not in here. And when the church became unified around the vision that God has for reaching the nations with the gospel of Jesus Christ, beginning in Jerusalem, ending in the ends of the earth, when that became our focus, folks, I don't know if you realize it, but the more we were focused on God's will and God's word and God's purposes, did you ever notice that the more we started looking outward and stopped looking inward, that suddenly we started to be healthy? And actually, people stopped worrying about the things that didn't matter, like carpets, like colors. And folks, it's something that we have to keep. Because all it takes is the devil finding one or two people that want disunity, that are focused more on themselves. I find it interesting, and I'll close with this, Kevin. You can come. Several centuries ago, if you remember, ancient China, they wanted to secure their borders. If you remember, there were northern invaders coming down into China, and they really had an amazing, ingenious plan. You know what they did, because you can go visit it today. They built a great wall to protect the northern border. It was so thick that there was no way for anybody to knock it down. It was so thick that literally they could ride chariots on it, so you can't man, you know, the wall in every position and every place. But when they knew that an attack was coming, they could get chariots, they could get soldiers there in large numbers because of how thick and how big this wall was. And when you think about what they had done, they had posted these soldiers at different places. The chariots could rush when there was an attack. They had a superior advantage over the enemies because they were up over the top of them. They must have sat back and knew that they had successfully and sufficiently protected their borders against all the enemies. But in the first 100 years of the Great Wall of China being built, you may not realize that the nation was invaded three times successfully. You say, well, how in the world could they have possibly been invaded three times successfully with this great strength, with this great wall? You know what it was? Doesn't matter how strong the wall was, if the guy at the gate was only thinking about himself. If the guy at the gate couldn't be trusted, if he couldn't be loyal. And all they had to do was get one person to be disunified. And suddenly in that disunity, guess what? Now the gates are open. Now the devil has a way in. Folks, I don't know about you. I don't want to be the door through which disunity came into the body of Christ that Jesus died for himself. This body is more than just, I don't know, I mean, when I say more than, I mean, we're the church, but I want you to understand, more than the church, that has meaning. But let me tell you, it has more meaning when you think about it the way Jesus would say it over and over, that this church is his bride. Don't you remember what he told us about our own marriages? What God has brought together, what should no man do? He should never tear it apart. Make it your commitment that you'll never be the door to disunity in your family and amongst your Christian friends and this body of believers. Because don't think for a second. Go back to what we started with. Go back to what Spurgeon said in the beginning. Satan always, always hates Christian fellowship. It is his policy to keep Christians separated and apart. And the only way he can do it, he's going to try to do it through one of us. When you finish out this chapter, I won't read it, we're out of time. But when you finish out this chapter, now that the kingdom's united, the old enemy, the Philistines, they started coming back, right? Because though a kingdom's united, it doesn't mean the devil quits working. Two times the Philistines try to attack David. But with this unified kingdom, guess what? God does what he always says he'll do. He'll give victory. And now they begin to advance. Now they become what God intended them to become. And now, rather than leading out of Hebron, David is about to be given the city of David, Jerusalem. The Jebusites are there. And finally, after all these years, you start to see the kingdom advance. Why? Because now there's finally unity. How can you fight the enemy when you spend all your time fighting each other? And so, folks, let God speak to you this morning. Let him solidify in your heart the need for unity in every level of your life. Father, we thank you that, Lord, you've given us your word to guide us. You love us. Lord, you know what brings joy and hope and peace. Lord, you know how your purposes will be accomplished. And Father, you've shared in the Word of God how many times that it boils down to unity. Lord, when you prayed for us in John 17, one of the things you prayed was that they would be unified, that we would be unified. You prayed for us 2,000 plus years ago. You had us in mind when you prayed those words, that just as you and the Father we're together and unified, that we would be unified. So, Father, I pray that we would remember that in this room, who sits across from us is family. Lord, help us to see the best in each other, to not remember only the mistakes that are made, the struggles that we've been through, and we tend to sit back and say, well, they're just crazy, or they're just whatever. Lord, don't let us think like that. Lord, let us see each other as your precious bride. That we would care and be loyal and be faithful. And Father, give us the ability to center ourselves on your word and your will. For that is where true unity comes from, Lord. Father, there may be someone here today that they need to step into your will. Surrender their lives to you, Lord, that they need to step into forgiveness and into the family of God through the repentance of sins. Lord, someone here is lost in their sin, and Father, they so desperately need to just confess that they need help, that they need hope, that, Lord, they need your forgiveness and your freedom that only you can give because you died on the cross and were buried and you rose again on the third day. Lord, someone here needs to place their faith in you today. Lord, they're broken and they're hurting, and they don't know that you are mighty to save. But Father, may they know it now. And Lord, if they would but confess and believe and surrender to you, Lord, you would hear and you would save them. And so, Father, right where they are this morning, may they pray and seek your forgiveness and your new life. And may they let it be known by just coming forward while we sing to say, I want to be baptized and be part of this fellowship. So, Lord, do in us what you desire today. Speak to us, Lord, and let us speak to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, close your eyes just a moment. We're going to have a short invitation this morning. But I want you to pray. I want you to respond. He's spoken through music and prayers, most importantly through his word. What would you say to him? Could it be you're the disruption? The disunity. If you need Christ, pray. He'll hear you. Sing together.
Forever we will say.
Information with that knowledge, church, we go to share the love of Christ. God bless you. We love you. We hope to see you Saturday night for Nathan and Jenny's going away and for John's Q&A. You'll get more information on that through the week. We love you. God bless you. You're dismissed.